Welcome to the Daily Chronological Bible. My name's Hunter, and we are reading through the Bible in chronological order as a single story. And that story is all about Jesus. It is a revelation of Him, and He has revealed to us the heart of the Father. Today,
December the 3rd, we are in the book of Acts, chapters 21, starting in verse 37, through chapter 23. We're reading from the New Living Translation. This is the word of the Lord. Acts 21, starting in verse 37.
As Paul was about to be taken inside, he said to the commander, "May I have a word with you?"
"Do you know Greek?" the commander asked, surprised. "Aren't you the Egyptian who led a rebellion some time ago and took 4,000 members of the assassins out into the desert?"
"No," Paul replied. "I am a Jew and a citizen of Tarsus in Cilicia, which is an important city. Please, let me talk to these people."
The commander agreed.
So Paul stood on the stairs and motioned to the people to be quiet. Soon a deep silence enveloped the crowd, and he addressed them in their own language, Aramaic.
Acts 22.
"Brothers and esteemed fathers," Paul said, "listen to me as I offer my defense." When they heard him speaking in their own language, the silence was even greater. Then Paul said, "I am a Jew, born in Tarsus, a city in Cilicia, and I was brought up and educated here in Jerusalem under Gamaliel. As his student, I was carefully trained in our Jewish laws and customs. I became very zealous to honor God in everything I did, just like all of you today. And I persecuted the followers of the way, hounding some to death, arresting both men and women, and throwing them into prison. The high priest and the whole council of elders can testify that this is so. For I received letters from them to our Jewish brothers in Damascus, authorizing me to bring the followers of the way from there to Jerusalem in chains to be punished. As I was on the road approaching Damascus about noon, a very bright light from heaven suddenly shone down around me. I fell to the ground and heard a voice saying to me, 'Saul, Saul, why are you persecuting me?' 'Who are you, Lord?' I asked. And the voice replied, 'I am Jesus the Nazarene, the one you are persecuting.' The people with me saw the light but didn't understand the voice speaking to me. I asked, 'What should I do, Lord?' And the Lord told me, 'Get up and go into Damascus, and there you will be told everything you are to do.' I was blinded by the intense light and had to be led by the hand to Damascus by my companions. A man named Ananias lived there. He was a godly man, deeply devoted to the law and well regarded by all the Jews of Damascus. He came and stood beside me and said, 'Brother Saul, regain your sight.' And that very moment, I could see him. Then he told me, 'The God of our ancestors has chosen you to know his will and to see the righteous one and hear him speak. For you are to be his witness, telling everyone what you have seen and heard. What are you waiting for? Get up and be baptized. Have your sins washed away by calling on the name of the Lord.' After I returned to Jerusalem, I was praying in the temple, and I fell into a trance. I saw a vision of Jesus saying to me, 'Hurry, leave Jerusalem, for the people here won't accept your testimony about me.' 'But Lord,' I argued, 'they certainly know that in every synagogue I imprisoned and beat those who believed in you. And I was in complete agreement when your witness Stephen was killed. I stood by and kept the coats they took off when they stoned him. But the Lord said to me, "Go, for I will send you far away to the Gentiles."' The crowd listened until Paul said that word. Then they all began to shout, 'Away with such a fellow! He isn't fit to live!' They yelled, threw off their coats, and tossed handfuls of dust into the air. The commander brought Paul inside and ordered him lashed with whips to make him confess his crime. He wanted to find out why the crowd had become so furious. When they tied Paul down to lash him, Paul said to the officer standing there, 'Is it legal for you to whip a Roman citizen who hasn't even been tried?' When the officer heard this, he went to the commander and asked, 'What are you doing? This man is a Roman citizen.' So the commander went over and asked Paul, 'Tell me, are you a Roman citizen?' 'Yes, I certainly am,' Paul replied. 'I am too,' the commander muttered, 'and it costs me plenty.' Paul answered, 'But I am a citizen by birth.'
The soldiers who were about to interrogate Paul quickly withdrew when they heard that he was a Roman citizen, and the commander was frightened because he had ordered him bound and whipped. The next day, the commander ordered the leading priest into session with the Jewish High Council. He wanted to find out what the trouble was all about, so he released Paul to have him stand before them.
Acts 23. Gazing intently at the High Council, Paul began, "Brothers, I have always lived before God with a clear conscience." Instantly, Ananias the high priest commanded those close to Paul to slap him on the mouth. But Paul said to him, "God will slap you, you corrupt hypocrite. What kind of judge are you to break the law yourself by ordering me struck like that?" Those standing near Paul said to him, "Do you dare to insult God's high priest?" "I'm sorry, brothers, I didn't realize he was the high priest," Paul replied. "For the scriptures say you must not speak evil of any of your rulers." Paul realized that some of the members of the high council were Sadducees and some were Pharisees, so he shouted, "Brothers, I am a Pharisee, as were my ancestors, and I am on trial because my hope is in the resurrection of the dead." This divided the council, the Pharisees against the Sadducees, for the Sadducees say there is no resurrection or angels or spirits, but the Pharisees believe in all these. So there was a great uproar. Some of the teachers of religious law, who were Pharisees, jumped in and began to argue forcefully. "We see nothing wrong with him," they shouted. "Perhaps a spirit or an angel spoke to him." And the conflict grew more violent. The commander was afraid they would tear Paul apart, so they ordered his soldiers to go and rescue him by force and take him back to the fortress. That night, the Lord appeared to Paul and said, "Be encouraged, Paul. Just as you have been a witness to me here in Jerusalem, you must preach the good news in Rome as well." The next morning, a group of Jews got together and bound themselves with an oath not to eat or drink until they had killed Paul. There were more than 40 of them in the conspiracy. They went to the leading priests and elders and told them, "We have bound ourselves with an oath to eat nothing until we have killed Paul. So you and the High Council should ask the commander to bring Paul back to the High Council again. Pretend you want to examine his case more fully. We will kill him on the way." But Paul's nephew, his sister's son, heard of their plan and went to the fortress and told Paul. Paul called for one of the Roman officers and said, "Take this young man to the commander. He has something important to tell him." So the officer did, explaining, "Paul the prisoner called me over and asked me to bring this young man to you because he has something to tell you." The commander took his hand, led him aside, and asked, "What is it you want to tell me?" Paul's nephew told him, "Some Jews are going to ask you to bring Paul before the High Council tomorrow, pretending they want to get more information. But don't do it. There are more than 40 men hiding along the way, ready to ambush him. They have vowed not to eat or drink anything until they have killed him. They are ready now, just waiting for your consent." "Don't let anyone know you told me this," the commander warned the young man. Then the commander called two of his officers and ordered, "Get 200 soldiers ready to leave for Caesarea at 9 o'clock tonight. Also take 200 spearsmen and 70 mounted troops. Provide horses for Paul to ride and get him safely to Governor Felix." Then he wrote this letter to the governor. "From Claudius Lysias to His Excellency Governor Felix, greetings. This man was seized by some Jews, and they were about to kill him when I arrived with the troops. When I learned that he was a Roman citizen, I removed him to safety. Then I took him to their high council to try to learn the basis of their accusations against him. I soon discovered the charge was something regarding their religious law, certainly nothing worthy of imprisonment or death. But when I was informed of a plot to kill him, I immediately sent him on to you. I have told his accusers to bring their charges before you." So that night, as ordered, the soldiers took Paul as far as Antipatris. They returned to the fortress the next morning, while the mounted troops took him on to Caesarea. When they arrived in Caesarea, they presented Paul and the letter to Governor Felix. He read it and asked Paul what province he was from. "Cilicia," Paul answered. "I will hear your case myself when your accusers arrive," the governor told him. Then the governor ordered him kept in the prison at Herod's headquarters. And now may our Lord give his blessing to the reading and the hearing of his word. Amen.
Thank you for joining us at the Daily Chronological Bible. You can find the specifics of our reading plan in the one-year Chronological Bible published by Tyndall Press. And discover more about our other podcasts at dailyradiobible.com, where people from all around the world come to join us in this journey through the Scriptures, where we allow the Scriptures to point us to the God who is love, the God revealed to us fully in Jesus. Again, that website is dailyradiobible.com. Subscribe or follow wherever you get your podcast. Until tomorrow, let's go forward in God's joy. Let's let His joy be our strength. And let us always remember this, that you are loved. No doubt about it. Alrighty, I'll talk to you again tomorrow. Bye-bye.